Good afternoon, friends. I'll be talking about this topic, where do I get correct info on intensive care? So this talk, I gave it in Hicks Meet on 20th June 2020. So it's an interesting topic, mainly for youngsters who are preparing for exams. So the narrative of this topic is predominantly from my own individualistic perspective, and obviously you can't expect evidence-based sort of a narrative for this sort of a topic. So it is my own insights and my own experience and my own thoughts on all the literature that are useful in intensive care. So when you look at sources for intensive care, predominantly you look into the textbooks, journals, then web links, web resources and workshops, which gives you sort of an interactive exchange of information and knowledge between the mentor and the trainees. So the way I look at it is, whenever I'm preparing for any topic or for any exam, so I've always desired to make my own personalized notes. So which means any information I'm looking in is not sourced from one source. So I would be taking this information from multiple sources, and I've realized collating these inputs as their notes, as your own personalized notes, have always been very beneficial. And once I make notes, I try to group the information across various headings or across broad-based themes. And then based on those themes, which I have put it as a broad sort of a domains, then I would dwell into the depths and specific of these individual domains, which I've created as groups. So this is how I have always dwelled into any topic. So where I divide the topics into big domains, and within that domain, I dwell into the depth and specifics. And most importantly, along with whatever personalized notes one individual has made, it is important to supplement these personalized notes with the whatever material that you would be reading across the textbooks or across the web-based resources or across the journals. And most importantly, you supplement these notes along with the information you gain from the rounds that you do with your teacher or a mentor, or the doubts that you would have raised during the rounds, and those doubts that are clarified. You could always come down and jot down those points or add in those points or cues into the notes that you are trying to create. So that is something which I found very useful. So at my level, when I say attend a lecture of any sort, so I may make certain notes of the points, important points that may have been deliberated in the lecture, and I would supplement to the notes that I'm creating for the topic. So this one. And always make use of certain notes or scribbles that you'll make from the teaching that happens within your unit, or certain lectures that you would have heard online or in a virtual format. And supplement it with any research that you may have conducted on that particular topic, or your unit may have conducted in that particular topic, or your own institutional research that may have happened. So you could always add in few points, and that would add more weightage to the topic that you may be preparing on, or you may be preparing for exam. So whatever the case may be. So let's look one by one as to what are all the resources that I found useful. So when you look at the printed resources, all of us agree there's no one magical book for intensive care. So you can't come and say that I have read these books, but still I failed the exam. So that doesn't work, because you are expected to extract all the information that is needed about a topic from various sources. So when I say there's no one magical book, so you are expected to look into the reference books, the journals and the web-based links that would give you valuable information on the topic that you are desiring to prepare on. So when you are preparing for exam, based on the type of exam you give, you are meant to refer to exam-oriented books. So suppose you are giving EDIC, or suppose you are giving IDCCM, then MCQs is books, MCQ based books is something that you are expected to look into. If you are writing Australian exams or DNB critical care exam or DM, then it would be more of essay based narrative. So you would have to read up books which will help you to write a good essay. And if you are attending an exam like IFCCM or fellow or DNB critical care or Australian exam, so then you have OSCE stations. So there you may have to refer to the book which deliberates on data interpretation. So, and all this has to be supplemented by various apps, blogs and resource websites that are available, which I will go through the websites which are available. So suppose you are giving a US exam, then obviously your whole reference point will be medical board review and question bank for US based. So any exam you are giving, so it would be country specific, and you may have to dwell into the literature available from that country's perspective. So when it comes to books, so I would divide the books into the reference books and certain books which I believe every trainee has to read from page to page. So for me, I think this has been my Bible when I was preparing for intensive care exams in Australia. So the TCOS manual, so without exaggeration, I can candidly say I may have read minimum of 25 times from page to page, and I literally memorized every page of this book. So this is expected out of any trainee to at least memorize a small book which comprehensively covers all the salient fundamental core essence of intensive care. So this I would say you don't have to only pick up this book which I have took it up as a Bible. So I think most Indians tend to like Washington manual, because when I was doing my medicine post graduation, so medicine Washington handbook for general medicine, I had read page to page and literally had memorized. So although it is a small book, but it is full of stuff because it is a small font print and it would be infused with lot of knowledge aspects. So, and I see in India most of them tend to like this Washington manual for critical care. So you could refer any of these books. And another book is the Marin's ICU book. So this is also a small book which is reasonable to be read page to page and comprehensively grasp the salient aspects and memorize them. So these are the three books that I have just illustrated. If you have any other book, you can let me know. But those three books, if you have read page to page and you have a good grasp of the concepts, you would pretty much would have covered more than 60 to 70% of what is expected out of you from intensive care standpoint. So if you are giving a Viva or a quick reference book, I think this is a good book which is called Critical Care Secrets, which gives you a good snippets which helps you in Viva answering and even MCQs. So this I would suggest for any exam where there is Viva. So you have IDCCM, there is a Viva. You have EDIC, there is a Viva. So you have a DNV, there is Viva. Australian exam, you have a Viva. So it is a good adjunct to supplement with your books that you would read from page to page. So along with this, that is not good enough. There are something called reference books. So reference books, one cannot expect you to have memorized from page to page. So these are very big and very exhaustive books, but these are good for reference to supplement your personalized notes from those Bible books, along with some of the important aspects that you would have derived from this reference book. So Irwin Rippey is a very exhaustive book, very good book. You could use it as a reference. And so this is a Fink book, which is also a good book, which is quite a big book. You can refer for any useful information to supplement your personalized notes. So this book, not many of the current generation would remember. So around 20 years back when I was entering intensive care, so this I used to read quite a bit, and it was a very good book. I'm sure some of my contemporaries like Sunil Karant or Srinivas Samvedam would have definitely read this book. It's a very good book. It is outdated because the last edition came on 1999. It's called Oxford Textbook of Critical Care. Even now, I mean not now in the sense, even when I was in Australia, I used to refer some of the aspects of this book because it does deliberate on good physiological aspects of critical care. So even now I have a photocopy of this book. So it's a good book, but now it's outdated. Now some of the physiological aspects, it was pretty good for us. So having done this, then you have to dwell into journals. So journals, this has also become little out of vogue because all the journal articles now could be got on a touch of your finger, on the apps or on a website. So around 10-15 years back, we used to get this yearbook of critical care. As you see, it is 2013. You had this yearbook every year. It used to be a compilation of all the key journal articles that used to come, and this was very useful for preparing any talk or even for giving any exam. It just gives a quick insight into all landmark articles on critical care. But I would say this possibly has gone out of vogue now because you have a lot of blogs and a lot of websites, which I'll take you through. So when you look at journals, so when I was doing the preparation for this talk, so there are around 58 intensive care journals, and this is a good sort of illustration of all these journals, based on the impact factor and the rating. So you have a SGR rating and the index number here, index rating. And as you see, there are 58 journals, critical care medicine amongst intensive care tops the impact factor. So what I wish to draw upon is this current opinion in critical care. So this, as you see, is in the ninth position. It has a good rating of around 53. So this is an extremely good book which covers all the review articles. And these review articles come in a thematic way. So what that will help you is, so you would have one issue which may cover thematically about all the hemodynamic articles, and it may come thematically to cover all nephro articles. It may come thematically to cover all renal articles. So if you are looking at any one topic, I think this is one book which you can pick up, and if you read a good review article on that topic, it would pretty much have encompassed all the recent journal updates, and it gives you a good insight or grasp into that topic you are looking into. So it's a very good book. I used to refer it quite often when I was preparing for Australian exam. And our Indian Journal of Critical Care Medicine, you see it is at 29th position with an impact factor of around 9, which is not the best of the impact factor. But why I put it as a highlight is, see, some of the Indian specific guidelines that may be asked in the exams, be it IDCCM, IFCCM or DNB, would be covered. So there are certain unique diseases or certain unique conditions, say end of life. So when you have to deliberate on end of life, you would want to know the Indian perspective, right? So for that, you have to refer to Indian Journal of Critical Care, where we have come out with a position statement on end of life or brain death status. So there are a lot of legal ramifications in our country. All this is covered in our position statement. So for those aspects, definitely you would have to refer to our own Indian Journal of Critical Care Medicine. And this was all the list of all the intensive care specific journals from various countries that is been listed on the site. So as I mentioned, there are around 58 intensive care specific journals from various countries, and this is the list. And these slides, as I said, I'm going to put it up on the website, so you can go through anytime, and I can share it with anyone in a PDF format. So when it comes to Indian medical journals, so these are some of the journals which have a reasonably good impact factor. Indian Medical Journal is one, Indian Academy of Clinical Medicine, National Medical Journal of India, JAPI, and Indian Journal of Anesthesia. So these are the reasonably good journals to cover the base specialty of medicine or intensive care or anesthesia linked to intensive care from these journals. So these are reasonably good Indian journals. But this slide is most important. The top three journal articles where you would see all the landmark articles come from these articles, from these journals. New England Journal, you see impact factor is very high, followed by Lancet, followed by JAMA. The typical example is the current COVID. When you look at COVID, any landmark article until now, you would have seen them coming out in either NEJM or Lancet or JAMA, isn't it? So most of the landmark articles, and that is also reference. So most landmark trials and articles in last 2 years have come in these top three journals. So you cannot be agnostic to these three journals. So any of the key practice changing articles that we may have to refer to intensive care comes from these three journals, and you may have to keep an eye on these three journals. Okay, now coming to MCQ. So there are a lot of MCQ books, but I'm only talking about the books that I may have gone through at some point of time. So for part one EDIC exam or for any other, I think this was a good, Bennington was a good MCQ. Now there are a lot of Indian MCQ books that have come, so I have not gone through them, so that's why I have not put in here, but you can refer it and you can let me know which have been very useful. And this is also a very good critical care MCQs that came in December 2014. And for CBS is case-based scenarios. Like in Australia, you have OSCE or case-based scenarios that are given in OSCEs. For that, this book which came from Bala Venkatesh from Australia, this was a Bible for us for our OSCE, which was very useful. You can still refer it to it. And this one also is a very good book from UK, Stephen Bonner. So this gave a very good comprehensive case-based scenario of all different dimensions of intensive care. Okay, now we'll move to the web links. UpToDate is mandatory. I'm sure most of the trainees who are working in good institutes would have UpToDate provided by their own institutes. Like in Columbia Asia, our institute has given us up to date, so all our trainees have up to date on their apps, which they can refer it to. And this is a must for every trainee to look into, because this really gives you a bird's view into any of the topics that you wish to dwell upon. And this and the topic that you are looking into are linked to various journal articles within the up to date website. And this I would say is a must have, and it's a very ready reckoner for any of the answers that are looking for any questions in intensive care in mind. PubMed, I'm sure many of you would be going through. So these are some of the things which you may have to refer to for any answers in intensive care. MD Consult. So PubMed, up-to-date MD Consult, I'm sure many of you are aware. So these are lesser known web links, which some of them are paid, some of them are free, and which may be pharma funded, like Knowledge Genie is a pharma funded. Micromedics may have some funding, but there is some fee that has been put in when I checked yesterday. Hinari is another one. So these are all paid sort of a website where you may have to have subscription to source multiple journals from these sites. And Open Athens is a big sort of a library where you can access multiple journals, but you need a subscription for it. The new kid on the block is SkyHub. I'm sure many of you would be aware of the SkyHub. So this, it's difficult to put my recommendation on record because it's a pirated version. Literally, you can get any journal full text on this SkyHub. So any journal you can access through this SkyHub. I'm sure many of you are aware, many of you are using. But as I said, it's hard to recommend because this is a pirated version, but I'm sure many of you are using. So I just thought I'll put it up. So this is a new kid on the block, which I'm sure many trainees are looking into to get to source their full text articles. So the web resources. So those are all the journal access sites and the journal sites in one way in it's a one-stop solution to get all the information. So what about the web resources? So if you are, so web resources, some of them are the course specific or exam specific, like PACT. PACT is a very specific to EDIC preparation. So anyone preparing for EDIC have to be enrolled to PACT and have to go through their own questions or case-based scenarios for you to crack the exam. For ECGs, you have these websites, ecgpedia.org or necgpedia.com. It's a good website. There are multiple other websites, but I have found these websites quite useful to look into ECG. For radiology, I found this website very useful, MedEd Virginia and Wiki Radiography. So MedEd Virginia goes through in a very systematic way on all the normal imaging and the abnormal imaging. And all these imagings are segregated into system wise, so it makes it very easy for you to learn the normal and the abnormal features in any imaging. For echo, you can refer to ICU sonography website by CMC Vellore. It is quite a good one. So there are a lot of YouTube videos on echo, so but I think this CMC one, which is a narrative with images, is a good way to comprehensively grasp the core essence of echo, and then you can refer all the YouTube videos. So we'll get into the blogs. So this CritIQ has a lot of blogs and websites. So CritIQ.com is a good sort of a blog which gives into various dimensions of intensive care. But what I found very useful is CriticalCareReviews.com. So CriticalCareReviews, as you see, this is a blog bar website which has all this journal watch, newsletters, hot articles, major studies, review articles, critical care journals, and it even has podcasts. So the good thing is the journal watch is literally given to you on a monthly basis. So basically every month you know what has been the recent update with regards to the journals that have come. Even you have podcasts and vodcasts, and then you have major studies. So if you really want to only look into the major studies, you go into the major studies, you click it and you get all the major studies. Or you go into the review article, you get all the review articles. So this is a very good sort of a blog bar website, which I found extremely useful when you're preparing for any talk or any topic in general. So intensivecarenetwork.com is another one. So again, see, right now what I see is every website bar blog have their own podcasts. So there's a lot of podcasts embedded into every website. So even intensivecarenetwork.com has a podcast, and then it has an exam help, then it has all the latest updates in this. So then you have this wellingtonicu.com. This is an Australia New Zealand specific website. So this would help any trainees bar candidates who are desiring to prepare for Australian exam or who are willing to enter into Australia. The reason being, it even looks into the the recruitment aspect. So it does gives you the advertisements for all the jobs that may be available. So it may be useful for Indians who are desiring to go to Australia to look into this website and to try to grasp into what are the latest updates in intensive care that are happening in Australia bar New Zealand. Critical Care Forum is an US one, so even here this website has lot of dimensions or links or subheadings into various aspects of critical care, including journals. And I'm sure Life in the Fast Lane, many of you would be looking. This is an Australian-based blog, so very popular amongst people who are preparing for any talks or debates. So I found this very useful, especially when I'm preparing for a debate. So when I looked into yesterday's, as you see, there is a dexamethasone, whether it is good. So the good thing about Life in the Fast Lane is it critically evaluates every article and gives you a critical standpoint on the limitations of the studies. So any of the listeners who would have gone through Australian training would know that every art there in exam, it is expected that you critically evaluate a journal, and that is a question which goes as a part of your exam in Australia. So here the good thing about this blog is it critically analyzes every article and gives you a critical sort of an appraisal of an article. And then you have a US-based Society of Critical Care Medicine blogs. So this also shows different blogs within and various references to various articles and other newer updates in intensive care. So now we have finished the blogs, we finished the journals, we finished the books, we finished the blogs. Now about apps. So ICU Trials is an app that you can have it on the phone. So I've seen many of my trainees having this Trials app, which is very useful. And if you see, it goes alphabetical order. So as you see, you see a Arts Trial and you see ArtsNet Trial, and it goes in the alphabetical order. And this is also quite useful to have it on your phone, right? Then you have ICU Pulse. So ICU Pulse also gives you a lot of tidbits into various aspects of intensive care, and these are useful for trainees. It is on the click of the button, you get a lot of information on the ICU updates and ICU core essence of ICU dimension. So then you have this ICU Notes also, where you again get a lot of useful information and updates. So I have gone through cursorily in all this. I found ICU Trials to be very useful. ICU Pulse may be useful for any exam going candidates to get the some of the essence that is derived from the core topics. And ICU Notes for anyone who wish to write a narrative on any of the topics as an essay, it is useful. So these are all apps which are ready reckoners on the phone. So if you are going by flight or traveling anywhere, this may be useful for you to be glancing through whilst you are going for exams. So I can't finish this talk without mentioning about my own website, which I've created, which is a free website, www.drpradeeprangappa.com. As you see, you go to the exam lectures, there are more than 100 core intensive care lectures that are uploaded, and this is work in evolution. So you would have more and more videos uploaded. The talk right now I'm giving will be uploaded in next one or 2 days. So you'll really have anything that I'm giving talks uploaded on this. And there's a lot of other things about my publications and about my own history of medicine through philately. So I have a lot of things that you can dwell onto it. So if you are really looking at websites in ICU, there are 31 websites which dwell into various aspects of intensive care from various countries and country-specific website. So this is the list of all the websites. So you can go through the list, make a note of the list that is useful for you, and you can see what list suits you. So these are all the, see, as you see, there are UK-based websites, there are South Africa-based websites, there is European-based websites, Australia, New Zealand-based website, and not to ignore our Indian-based websites as well. So then we talk about, so we have spoken about the books, we have spoken about the journals, we have spoken about the websites, we have spoken about the blogs, we have spoken about the apps, but we cannot underemphasize on all the workshops a trainee is expected to attend, because as you see, how much ever you read from theoretically or how much ever you grasp theoretically, it is extremely important to put it into a practical perspective, and that practical perspective comes from your mentors or teachers who have a rich experience, who would put into their experience into the clinical context or their practical wisdom into the theoretical aspects that you have gained. And that really is what matters. And though that information or that knowledge could be gained by attending the workshops. So you are expected to attend the basic intensive care workshops, or you are expected to attend the ACLS workshop, and you are expected to attend mechanical ventilation workshop, you are expected to attend hemodynamics workshops. So any of the workshops you attend, you will apply those theory into how to be utilized in the practical parlance, and you will get the wisdom and maturity of your seniors or the mentors to put it into perspective. I think that is where it becomes immensely useful. And what I've always believed is, having read through your theoretical aspects, having attended workshops, discussing within your unit amongst your peers and the group discussions will immensely enhance your knowledge gain. So this is something that every unit should do, and should encourage that these discussions happen in your own unit level platforms. And it is important to attend such conferences like BICS, Basic Intensive Care Symposium, that we do, or BITS, Basic Intensive Trainee Symposium, that we do in Bangalore. So Bangalore Intensive Care Symposium or Bangalore Intensive Care Trainee Symposium. So a lot of these activities will help you to define boundaries in intensive care, and will help you focus and concentrate on issues that seniors or mentors or teachers believe are important. And most importantly, it will help you to prioritize the topics that you are expected to know in depth. I think this is what this sort of a city-based conferences or city-based symposiums or city-based training workshops will equip you in. So this is just a last few slides on a trainee. Once they have done all their homework on preparing, reading all those what I mentioned, attended workshops, done their own in-house discussions. On exam day, it is important to plan travel arrangements 3 months in advance if you are traveling overseas or traveling interstate. Because when you plan 3 months in advance, you'll get a good deals. And close to and prefer it is desirable and preferable to have your place where you're staying close to the exam center, because it significantly reduces your commuting time, and it will reduce your anxiety on the day of exams. And most importantly, when you go for an exam, you make sure that you are dressed appropriately and you're formally dressed and well groomed. And generally, we do not like people coming with not shaven sort of a thing, because it just puts you puts an image that you know you're not very seriously committed to the exam. So it is important that you come well groomed and formally dressed. So I think the way you appear also makes some little impact on how committed you are towards this intensive care. And what I have always believed, it is important to do the recce of exam centers a day before. Even when I gave my medicine post-graduation exam, my center was in Jipmer. I remember I went one day prior, and I went and saw where the exam is conducted. Because these institutes like St. John's, although I'm trained in St. John's, for a newbie who comes into St. John's is a huge place. And you on the day of exam, you just land up into a place like St. John's Medical College, or you land up in Jipmer. You will be really lost. You wouldn't know, and your anxiety level is going to be very high on that day. And for you may go and ask a security guard where this is, and he may be clueless, because he may be a new security guard who has come on that day. So all these problems you have to anticipate, and it is always desirable that you do a recce. And I put up this because I did a recce of this center when I went to EDIC. I gave it in a place called Reddington. And if you see on the Google, this is the face of the Reddington Hospital. But had I gone on the day of exam, there is no way you will enter into the hospital from this entrance, because this is not the entrance. This is an old historic building, and the new hospital is on the back. So you have to make the whole entrance from the back of this building, and you have to find out which floor is this intensive care and how to enter the intensive care. So I made a recce into this one day prior. I went to this center, went to the ICU, so I knew the pathway leading to an ICU, and that will alleviate the anxiety significantly on the day of exam. So I would suggest each one of you should make a recce of your exam center one day before, or suit yourself what you think is best. And during exam, please, I request every trainee not to gossip on anything. Sit quietly and keep internalizing all that you have read. Internalize your thought process, and internalize and recall all the necessary information that you wish to articulate, rather than sitting and saying, "Oh, he's asking a difficult question. Have you studied this? Have you?" Because this will not help. So just sit quietly in a meditative phase, and preferably be away from people who are chit-chatting, and try to close your eyes and internalize your thoughts and try to recall what you have read in all your 2 to 3 years, and go with a very focused mind. So it's extremely important to have that focus, because your focus is to perform and be the best day on that day, and you have to perform to your to the zenith of your ability. So for that, keep the focus in mind, and never lose the focus until your exam is over. And when you are talking to an examiner, be loud, clear. Don't do mumbling, jumbling, because it is important to be loud, clear, and be confident in what you are articulating. And exam, no matter how you have performed in the exam, but reconcile in your mind that the whole process that you have gone through has only made you a better individual and has helped you to deliver the best care to the patient. Even if you have given 5 exams, the more exams you give, please bear in mind that better are you going to be. So never belittle yourself. Even if you have not succeeded first time in exam, the second time you give it, you convince yourself, reconcile to yourself, it has only made you a better individual, and it has gotten you to a better situation to treat your patients better and improve the outcome. So please bear that in mind and be proud of yourself. Look at yourself and be proud. With every exam you give, be proud of yourself and keep calm, and giving exams and passing is not the end of the world. So to reach the top, you don't have to be a bookworm. Just stay cool and give your best. And when I say give your best, it doesn't happen overnight. It has to be a relentless, resilient, committed, consistent, perseverant effort through your whole training program that really matters. So my best wishes are with all my trainees. So good luck for you. So I end with this quote. So it's ability to bring out the best in others that make you a leader. So thank you very much.